हाय सुष्मिता।
हाय सर, गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून। सो विल स्टार्ट। ओके, सो विल स्टार्ट विथ सम बेसिक क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम लास्ट लास्ट टॉपिक, देन विल कंटिन्यू द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक्स। ओके, सो टुडे विल बी 2 to 4। 2 to 4 विल बी द 2 to 6 एक्चुअली, and in between 14 15 minutes I'll give a break. Almost 4 to 4:15 we'll take a break. So this is our 4 hours, no? So we'll start. Yeah. So we'll start with quiz first, okay? That's as I told you, every time we'll start with quiz. Okay, he's stuck with rain, no problem. We'll run through the quiz. Meanwhile, he'll come back, he'll join.
Okay,
no problems, we'll start. So now first we'll start with the quiz. So last class, what we discussed? Can you tell me what all topics we discussed last class? We discussed, we discussed security roles and responsibilities, security, cyber security domains, and we discussed about this security terminologies, then CIA model, correct?
Yeah.
Now I'll ask questions from this, so you just answer in the chat window. Then we will go to the next topics.
Okay,
let's start. First question, what are the three classes of cyber security roles? You can answer in the chat window. Or if you're comfortable in speaking, you can speak also. It's okay, both are okay for me because there are only one student now. We can speak also. What are the three classes? If you don't know, if you don't remember, you can just put no in the chat window. You know the answer, right? Yeah. So let us write down that. So first we discuss about security. Okay, so first three classes: management, is engineering class, third is end user class. Okay, so what is the next question? What is security for management class? What is security for management class? Like for them, what is security for management class? Like CEO, VP, like that people know. For them, what is security? All around things. Okay. So for management class, security is a tool for business. Let me write down. For management class, security is a tool for business. Yes. Okay. For like, for example, if your organization has done a good security certification, the company will get good projects. So like that. So for them, it's actually a business, good tool for business. So then the engineering class, what is the engineering class will do is, for them, it is actually prevent from data. the unauthorized access. Access and data theft. That is your for pre-engineering class. And the end user class, if you see, end user class, what is the thing is? For them, it's a tool for work. So what is security, if you ask? They will say this is tool for business. This is preventing from engineering class will say preventing from unauthorized access and data theft. That is the security they will say. For a end user, what they say, it's a work. If I don't have proper security, my work will be affected. That's it. Now, what is the responsibility? What is the responsibility of management class? Now a management class is there. As a security consultant, what I'm expecting from a good management? What is the responsibility of a management class with respect to security? So what they have to do? What a management like CEO, VP, what they have to do? So the answer is, for a management class, what is their responsibility is identifying the threats. No. See, management class means understand. Management class is something like roles. If you take now, they are like CEO of the company, VP, board of directors, and security consultant, auditor. So these people, right? These people are. What is their responsibility? What they need to do with respect to security? Sushmita, are you able to understand the question? So the question is for. Yes, so for them, what I am expecting, what they need to do as a security personnel. What is their responsibility? So the answer is, if you remember, that is a diagram I draw. I'll show you the diagram now. Draw one diagram. Yeah, you can see this diagram. In this diagram, I told you there is a framework. Global customers, they required certifications. According to the certifications, laws, regulations and standards, you need to create, based on the guidelines of these standards, you have to create a policy. So this policy and give them a standard operating procedure and make sure that everybody follows this. This is the responsibility of a management class. So management class will go to the customers, see what all the standards customers are looking, global customers are looking. According to that, they will, based on their standards, regulations, guidelines, they will create a company security policy. And according to the policy, they'll create a standard operating procedures and make sure that enforce that everybody follows that end user and engineer follows that standards. So this is called what? Security, the responsibility of a end user, or what you call management class. So the answer is. OK, so the answer is to create. To create this is for management class, okay? to create good security policy. And enforce the engineering and end users end user class to practice it. So they will make sure that everybody practice that. Okay, now this is your responsibility of management. So management job is what? Creating good security policy and make sure that everybody follows that. What is the responsibility of a engineering class? What is engineer responsibility? As an engineer, you're working as a, for example, you are a SOC engineer, like L1, L2, L3, right? What is your responsibility? Or you are a security analyst? So the answer is, okay. Sushmita is trying. Very good. Perform assessments. Very good. So the answer is to implement security controls. Implement security controls as per organization's security policy. See, it's very important. You do all the security controls, but the security control has to come through organizational security policy. Not like whatever I know I cannot implement. So now the next question is, what are the security controls we have? We have three types of security controls. What are they? What are the three types of security controls we have? Next question. Okay, what are the security controls we have? Three types are there, security controls. Anybody? In implementing a security, there are three ways we can implement the security. It's not only putting firewall. There are so many other things are there. By only putting firewall, we cannot secure any company. So what are all the things we need to use to secure a company? Okay, I'll give the answer. First is administrative controls. Second is technical or logical controls. Third is physical control. So security is, it's not always, putting firewall, IPS, IDS. So apart from that, there are so many other controls are there. So what are the examples for technical control, administrative controls? Next question. What are the examples for administrative controls? Administrative controls. So when you want to implement your security, we put some administrative controls. So what are the examples for administrative controls? Okay. conducting trainings. Very good, very good. I got an answer from Susmita. Anybody else want to try? What is administrative control? Give me some examples for administrative controls. So administrative control means basically more on signboards. Some signboards, important signboards, and you can have registers. You got to sign and go registers. And as he said, he, she said, like conducting trainings, awareness trainings, awareness trainings. So make sure that everybody knows that what is they have to do. You put a board, you put a signboard saying that you put make up a signature. Everybody has sign and go. So you can have to enforce that there's a security area. Apart from putting security components, security devices, you also can create with different methods. You can create a signboard and implement that. Okay. Next. What is the technical or logical controls? Example, is this everybody can tell? What are technical controls, logical controls? I think who are all there now? We have Syed is there. Syed, good afternoon. Are you able to speak?
Good afternoon, sir. Yes, sir. I'm able to speak.
Okay, you are able to understand the questions? You are able to understand the question answer?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. So what are the technical controls? Any idea?
No.
Okay, fine. So I'll make a note on this. Everything is very important, basic stuff, but it's very important because we will be building all the next topics based on that only. Okay, Syed?
Yes, sir.
You can make a note. If you have a notebook or pen, or if how you have to make a note on these things, very important. Okay.
Yes, sir. Noting
every down. Time, whenever I'm going to discuss, I will be discussing based on this only. Okay. Three levels of three classes of security is there: management class, engineering class, and end user class. And they have different roles and responsibilities. So you will get a job when you join a company. You'll be joining as a SOC engineer. Okay.
Okay.
SOC engineer, or security analyst, or pen tester, like that, you'll get a job. But that time you need to know that these other roles are there. What they do and how, what is your role? You have to be very clear. Okay. Okay. Yes, the answer for this is Susmita. You know the answer? Technical controls. I think Susmita gave an answer also already. She gave firewall. Very good. So firewall, IPS, IDS / IPS, okay, AAA, VPN, web security, lot of things I can write down. Just write down something like important, email security, cloud security, all these security devices you have to install. That is called a particular. What are the example of physical controls? Physically, how you protect? Syed, you can tell physically how you protect. What are the physical controls you can put? Locking systems. Very good. I got an answer from Susmita. Locks. Very good. This is also physical control only. Apart from that. So the answer is, I'll tell you, CCTV camera is there. No, CCTV camera, access control door. Nowadays locking system is coming. No, access controls like locks, physical locks. And the fence, big electrical fence are there, fencing system. Then you have barricades, a lot of things you can put, keep on putting a lot of things. This all comes under physical controls. Now next, what is the role is a non-technical employee? Non-technical person, they all comes under end user. So what is the responsibility for a end user? What is the responsible for a end user? What he will do, what is his responsibility as an end user? You are a non-technical employee. What is your responsibility? Very good. Very good. So the answer is, he must have awareness. Awareness. He must have awareness of all security attacks. That is his responsibility. Tomorrow he must not say that, no, I don't know what is social engineering attacks. So many social engineering attacks are there. So he must not tell that, I don't know this is, I must not give these details. No. So these things he was not tomorrow say that, okay? He must have awareness. For that, how can we give awareness for him? It is management responsibility to give trainings, awareness trainings. And he will actually, he has to go to all the trainings, pass the exam, he has to pass the exam, small online exams you can keep, and you can have small drills, all these things. But make sure that everybody is aware of, even technical or non-technical, aware of all attacks. One thing is very important, whenever anybody from technical or non-technical is vulnerable for us, as a security point of view, you are technical or non-technical, if you are carrying a laptop, if you are carrying a computer in the company, you are a user of the network, you are vulnerable for me. If you don't, the attacker can use you and come inside without your knowledge also. Okay. Okay, both of you just tell me, all good. If both of you clear on this, everyone is clear on this, just give Y in the chat window, then I'll go. Kotari clear? Susmita clear? What about Syed? Syed, you are clear now? Any questions you can ask me. I want Syed also clear. So if you have any questions, please ask me. I will clear there and there. Now my next day also, tomorrow also, I'll ask you daily. I will check this because I want to make sure that everybody is clear on that point. Next, I am going to cover today some security controls. Okay. I think Syed is there. Susmita is there. Rakesh also joined. Hi Rakesh, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Okay, so now we have covered this yesterday class. I'm just revising it. Okay. So I will finish this, then we'll go to next topic. So we have discussed about the security roles and responsibilities. Next, we're going to discuss about some quiz. You keep on answer the question. So next I will go to cyber security domains. Just type the six cyber security domains. And type in the chat window. What are the six cybersecurity domains? You can answer in the chat window. Very good. Syed gave one answer. Network security. This is basically your CNT, CCNT, CCNA, CCNP, CCIE security. Okay. All comes under network security. Second is Kotari gave some answer. Very good. VA and VA/PT. Okay. Now VA/PT may, there are two is there. One is vulnerability assessment one and attack methods. This is one thing that you study in CEH. This course is CEH. CEH will teach you the vulnerability assessment and the attack methods. Then pen testing, penetration testing. The course will be like CPENT and the LPT. And we have third one is forensics. In forensics, we'll study the course is CHFI, where we study the how do you find the digital evidence for the cyber crime. Vulnerability assessment is just to understand what all the security weaknesses are there. Penetration testing means you are going to find out which are the penetrable means exploitable vulnerabilities. Okay, that is penetration testing. Then we have forensics. In forensics, we study the digital, finding the digital evidence for the crimes, cyber crimes. Next, we have SOC. The courses are like CSA, ECIH, and EDRP. So other SOC training. Then we have next in SOC there are two things are there. Important thing, let me write on that. In SOC we have two things. They are incident response management. Other one is disaster recovery management. What is incident response? Daily operation. Disaster recovery means if whole disaster, whole network goes down, recovery, whole resource network goes down, how do you manage that? That is your, this is daily operations. Okay, so disaster recovery means you'll create a backup DR, backup DR site. Okay, next is a fourth one is software. Basically, it's application security. You secure the application. We call it as secure coding. Secure coding. And the courses are like we have .NET, Java, PHP, Python. Okay, this all comes under in that. Next, we'll go to study software. Then we have governance. So governance, we'll study about laws, regulations and standards. Okay. And here we will learn how to create a security policy. Remember the management class, right? So how to create a security policy, all these things will teach you. What all things has to be considered when you're creating a security policy. And the courses are CCISO, securities, secure certified information security officer, and another course is CISSP. Very good. Good. Six domains, we know that. Now, can I go to the next topic? All of the three is clear. Shayad, Sushmita, and Rakesh. Domains, any questions in this? Any questions in security domains? Anything you want to ask? Okay, all of three is clear. Very good. Next, we'll go for this one. Terminologies. 10 terminologies we studied. Security terminologies. Okay, let me tell you one by one. You'll give me the answer. Okay. First, you can answer in the chat window. So what is that? Okay. That. So first we studied asset. What is asset? What is asset? Very good. I got some answer from Rakesh. Some answer from. Very good. But that for a security professional, what is our, we consider as asset? I understand what you're saying. So people property is very good. But for a security professional, what is considered as asset? Very good. The answer Shayad gave, data. Data, and another word is data. Correct answer. Very good. Shayad and Sushmita gave right answer. Data, and another thing is important is information. Very good. Correct. Sushmita gave the answer. So these are the two things we call it as asset. And that asset also we will focus only on something called data. Data is something like logs, you know, your device logs are there, you know, that are data. But what is information? Information means you collect the data, using the data, you create some intellectual property. We call it IP. IP means intellectual property. Okay, this intellectual property is called what? It's called what? Asset. So these IPs are there, like for example, your company template, company project design document. When you want to create any software, there is some guide in software development, design guide. So many things company will develop for their employees. The templates, guides, no? That will help us to do the job easily. So that information you must not share with anybody. It's all intellectual property for the organization. So that is called an asset. Now, what is vulnerability? Very good. Syed gave the answer. All of you gave the answer. The vulnerability means weakness. Security weakness. Security weakness of the asset. Okay. Next, what is attack? This weakness can be in any level. I told you, like, it can be in policy level, it can be in design level, it can be in protocol level, it can be in configuration level, even can be in a and even end user awareness also. That is also a vulnerability. User awareness is not there, means that is also user level. This all comes under vulnerability. So vulnerability can be in any level. Awareness. Yeah. Next, what is an attack? Very good. Akesh gave the answer. Sushmita gave the answer. Very good. So data theft, the unauthorized access. And data theft is this one. Next we are going to study. What is exploit? Very good. Syed gave the answer. See, whenever you do attack, the attack, it's not mandatory to become successful, right? It may have multiple options there. So to become successful, you need to do the. It has to be successful. If it is successful, we call it as exploit. Exploit means the attack is successful. So how do you say that attack? Attack means what? Attack means breach inside the system or network via vulnerability. Breach means you are successful in the attack. You went inside via vulnerability, any vulnerability. That is called exploit. Okay, what is threat? Very good. Sushmita, the correct answer. Ongoing attacks. Now it is happening. Attacks, now it's happening, is ongoing attacks are called threats. So what is risk? What is a risk? Very good. I can give an answer. Okay, risk is basically what is the impact and prioritization. So impact you have to find out. So based on that, you have to prioritize the risk. Price is the threat. Prioritize the threat. So impact and prioritize priority. You can put priority or priority. So it's priority. No, it's called risk, impact and priority. Now what are the two analysis we'll do for finding the risk priority? Like low, medium, high and critical risk. So different types of risk, you know. So these are the risk level. So what are the two analysis we'll do to find the risk level? A risk assessment, critical risk. Very good. I got answer. First is cost benefit. Who gave the answer? Rakesh. Yeah. Cost benefit analysis. Second one is business impact, BIA. Business impact analysis. Next, countermeasure. So what is countermeasure? For high and critical risks, we will implement the critical risk. Implementing security controls. That is called countermeasure. So again, what are the three security controls we have? What are three security controls we have? Just now we studied. Very good. Admin level, technical, and physical. Based on that, you implement that. After implementing the countermeasures, what happened to the risk? Risk is, what are the three ways risk can be mitigated? So what are the mitigation type modes or mitigation methods? After implementing countermeasure, what are the three ways we can give mitigation? First is, you can stop the risk. You can reduce the risk. Reduce means it is going from, like for example, you have a high risk, you after implementing countermeasures, you made the risk to low risk, but risk is there, but the level is reduced now. That is reducing the risk. Okay, then last one is, I'm not able to stop or reduce the risk. So what I did, I just gave awareness by the countermeasure. Awareness you have delivered. Next, what is DoS attack? What is denial of service attack? Denial of service means what? This attack. Okay, stopping the service, stopping attack from one PC. Okay, stopping the service to user. Okay, very good. So basically you are stopping the service of one machine. So what is doxing attack? So what is doxing attack? same information to attack another person. Using same information, what is that, Syed? Okay. Or multiple PC. What is doxing attack? Doxing attack is basically blackmailing to publish. Blackmailing to publish personal information in social media. They'll ask money, they'll do something, they'll ask you to do something, you have to do it. So this is something like they will threaten you, they'll blackmail you. Nowadays it is happening, right? So it is called what? Like Facebook, like this. Doxing attack. Okay, terminology is clear. Anybody has any questions? Can we go to the next topic? Okay, Sushmita clear, Rakesh clear. Sahid also clear, very good. So next we studied five elements. So what are the five elements we studied? Information security. Information security. Five elements. What are they? One. So they are yes, confidentiality, integrity, availability, authenticity. Of non-repetition. Spelling, I'll see. What is the spelling? Non-repetition. This is the spelling. Okay. Non-repetition. So last class, let me check what I have covered. So I covered up to confidentiality, integrity and availability. So I have not talked about the next two. Okay, I'll ask some questions in that and then we'll go for the next two also today. Okay, what is confidentiality? What is confidentiality? Okay. Now let's see what is the answer they given. City data, who can access? Very good. Who can? Rakesh give the answer, right? Yeah. Who can access data? What are two types of data we have? Very good. Since I give the answer, data in rest, data in motion. Now, what is data in rest means? The server data is in the server. It's not traveling anywhere, but the data is in the server. So, what attack will come in data in rest? Data in rest. What attack? Attack. Just tell me what attack we studied. Very good. I can give the answer. Brute force attack. Brute force attack means basically. Brute force attack means basically. Now we are going to discuss about. Password guessing attack. The algorithm will, the tool will guess the password and do multiple logins and find out what is the password. It's password guessing attack. What is the countermeasure for that? Okay, strong password policy. Very good. Strong password policy. Data in transit. When the data is moving from one location to another location, what is the attack? Yes, the attackers give the answer. Man in the middle attack. What is the countermeasure? Very good. So the answer is encryption. We'll go deep on encryption. The next topic is coming. Now I'm not going to touch the topic. I have actually, we discussed encryption a little bit deeper, but I have a next chapter where we'll go in very deeper on the encryption. So that's why we'll take a separate topic. At that time I'll discuss again on the encryption. So as of now, just I put encryption. Encryption is converting plain text to ciphertext. That's it. Next, integrity. What is integrity? Whatever security we are going to study, all comes under this five elements only. Permutation and combination of these five elements only will become your security. So it's like a OSM model, seven layers. So you have to be very clear on this. Okay, very good. Answer Sushmita gave. Modification of data, very good. Who can change data? Okay, modification of data. What is the attack? Attack again, we can take MITM. And what is the countermeasure? Question is, what is the countermeasure for integrity? Hashing. Another one is very good. HMAC. Hashing means we just use the algorithm. HMAC, we use algorithm plus a pre-shared key. That's it. So the hacker, if he change the, he cannot create the hash code. HMAC, because you need to create a hash code, you need the pre-shared key. That is the benefit in HMAC. What is availability? Very good. So availability is 24/7 access to data for authorized users. Very good. So what is the attack? There are two types of attack is there. One is nature made. Man-made. Nature made, what are the examples? Man-made. Nature made means man-made is DOS. You can say DOS, DDoS. Nature made is what are the attacks? Five elements of earth. Okay. So what is the attack? Attack you can tell like this, fire. Okay, fire you can say like that. Flood, water, flood. Okay, I got it. So nowadays fires are happening, fire like forest fire is coming now. You can say flood is happening, a lot of places flood is there, earthquake is there. Very good. this. What is the countermeasure for this? For availability, what is the countermeasure? Very good. One countermeasure is DRP. Another one is BCP. So BCP is business continuity planning. And DRP is disaster recovery planning. Now business continuity planning is mainly focusing on people and process. Business continuity planning, disaster recovery planning is focusing on the technology. DRP, we have technology will have backup DR site. But also different types are there. We have a cold DR site. Warm DR site. And hot DR site. Cold means after the primary phase, secondary to come up will take 1 week time. Warm means after the primary phase, it will take 1 day. Hot means immediate. It's no delivery. No delay. Immediate. Okay. Hot site. So different ways are there. Depends on the criticality of the application. We don't put all application in hot site because it's very costly solution. Parallelly running another data center. So what we do generally, we use the hot site only for the critical applications. Okay, for only critical applications, we use the hot site. Okay, fine. So this is clear. Next we'll go to okay. Till now we discuss about this. Any questions in this? All clear? All good? Can I go to authenticity and non-duplication? Okay. Sushmita clear. Sayed. DR means what? Disaster recovery. Disaster recovery site. Like a backup site. If one data center fails, you have another data center where you will have all the data centers, all the data is there. So you can, if any disaster, for example, big disaster happened, whole data center went inside, right? We have a DR, disaster recovery site is there. That is called DR site. Understood? Sayed? Okay. I think Sayed clear, Sushmita clear. Rakesh? Who else is there? I think we have Ali. Ali, Sayed, okay, 3 is there, okay, fine. Follow me is not there. Rakesh Srivasta.
Yes, so, sir.
Rakesh Srivasta is different, huh?
Yeah, myself is Rakesh Devendran.
So you joined first time or is...
No, I joined the intro class also.
Okay, fine. So two are absent today. Fine, let's continue. Now we will start with authenticity. Authenticity means we are going to verify the source of the data, not the data is changed or not. Verify the source of the data. Meaning, I want to make sure that when I open a website, this website is original source, like it is origins from server, it is hosted. It's not a attacker's website host. So how do I verify that? Like in between man in the middle, the attacker is stopping the original website and you hosting his server website as original. How do I verify that this is original website from the original server or it is attacker's website? Okay, how do I verify the source? That is called authenticity. The countermeasure for this is digital signature. Digital. This is the countermeasure. Now, what is the non-repetition? Non-repetition means after you implement, after you send or after you receive anything data, you are denying it. No, I didn't receive. For example, I send data to Rakesh today. I send a mail. Tomorrow Rakesh is saying, no, I didn't receive your mail. Or I send a message in WhatsApp. Tomorrow Rakesh says, I didn't receive your message. Okay, so for that, what is the countermeasure? Like WhatsApp, you're sending a message. Tomorrow you're saying, I didn't receive the WhatsApp message. So what is the countermeasure for that? So what is the countermeasure? So what is non-repetition attack? After receiving or sending the data, denying it. Denying after sending or receiving message. What is the countermeasure? You get something called this is basically for you can get something called read receipts. Example, you take this receipt what is that? WhatsApp, you know, WhatsApp. In WhatsApp, you'll get the two tick marks. So what is the meaning of these two tick marks? Two tick marks are coming, no? What is the meaning? One is delivered, another one is read, right? Something like that. So there are some read receipts are there where you can understand that I is received and read also. This is the non-repetition attack. And what is non-repetition attack is basically you are actually denying the after receiving and sending the message. Okay, so user level you can do this. Level play will play like I didn't receive the message like that. You can say that boss, I have a receipt that you received the message and you read the message on this time. Like that you can give the receipt to them. Same way in email also we can do. Email, when you send an email, you can attach a read receipt. Whenever that email is read from the other side, you'll get a reply mail to you. The options are available in the email softwares also. Outlook, everywhere it is there. Okay, so now we have finished the five elements of information security. Okay, let's go to the book now. Okay, let's start. Now what we discussed till now? CIA. My plan is to finish the book. So it has some, 12 chapters. We'll go through all the chapters one by one. Okay, so first we covered the CIA triad. So we understood what is CIA availability. Next, I'm going to talk about least privilege, defense and depth model. Okay, so next I'm going to talk about these two topics. The next topic is design. Or let me put like this, security architecture design principles. So there are four principles are there. Two they are telling in the book, but I will tell all the four. Doesn't matter. I'm okay with, I want to tell all the four. So the totally four principles are there in the book. They have only given two, least privilege, and maybe they will talk about other side after the another chapter. But when I touch the topic, I'll cover the full topic. So my plan is to tell you design architecture, design principles. First is least privilege. Okay. Least privilege means what? Second is defense in depth. Third is separation and rotation of roles and responsibilities. Job. Fourth, auditing. We do for two types of audit. One is policy, security policies are there, no? Security policy, are people properly, everybody is following the policy or not? To verify that, we have a policy compliance audit. They will check the audit. then we have something called the VAPT, vulnerability assessment and the penetration testing audit. Audits can be done in internal or external or external. So internally you can do for 6 months, you can do the audit, internal audits every year or per year or as per security or not security, what is it, audit certification standards. Certification standards. So how many years the certification is valid, that based on that you have to do the audits. Every time when the auditor comes and do the audit, they will tell you this certificate is valid for 1 year, 2 year, like that. So then again after 1 year you have to do the audit and review your certification. This is organization level certifications I'm telling. Okay, this is called auditing. So when we discuss about a security design, like for example, I'm working as a consultant. Somebody told me to design even a good security for a company. I will follow four principles. They are least privilege, defense in depth, separation and rotation of roles and responsibilities, like a job rotation, and auditing. So four things. First, let us start one by one. First, what is least privilege? Least privilege means by default, deny all, don't allow anybody, and give rights and permission as need to know basis. How much they need to know, that much only you give permission. Okay, this is called what? Least privilege. So what is this principle says is, by default don't allow anybody. If you want to allow somebody, just give them how much they want to know. Don't give much more permissions also. That is the first principle you have to follow in security. Second principle is defense in depth. Defense in depth means multi-layer security. What is this? For example, okay, let me make one small topology here. So I'm going to draw one small topology. Okay. Now this topology is having a core switch. I'm going to explain you some components, some design architectures now. So we are going to, today my main intention is to teach you some important designs. Okay, how the security design will be built, how the network designs are built. Okay, we're going to discuss on this design point of view. It's very important. So as I always says, if you want to protect one mall, first you need to know how the mall is designed, how the mall is built, right? If you don't know that, you cannot secure the mall. So same way, I'm going to talk about now how the networks are designed. So we are going to use devices here to explain you this. Now these all are like servers. Server one, like that I have some 10 servers are there in this data center. And this is my data center switch. This is my core switch. I don't hear core. This is my distribution switch. Distribution switch. And this is my access switch. This is my PC. Now in this organization, I have a one building. For each building, if you have three buildings, three switches will be there. So we have a campus. In the campus, I have one building. For the whole campus, one switch, core switch. For each building, I have created one distribution switch for building level. Then for each floor, I have access switch. This is my design. So core, distribution, access, data center switch. This is three tier architecture. What we call is three tier. Okay, this is a design, network design. Now I'm connecting a router. I want to go to internet. Okay, to go to internet, I'm going to use the ISP, internet service provider. Then I'm going to internet. This is my internet. Okay, I think that's it. So I have connected to my router is connected to my. Let's keep like this. Let me put like this. Connected to this. This is my ISP. This is my internet. This ISP is connecting to internet. Okay. Then I have one hacker here. He is a smiley hacker. Okay, so he is trying to hack your company servers. So this hacker who wants to hack your company, he is actually planning to hack your this one. Like your, this is my server, my file server, where I kept all my important data, file server, let's say. So he wants to hack your file server. So first I'll put a router here. Then connect it to your switch. Now we will discuss about, first we'll discuss about least privilege. So what is least privilege? So what is your understanding? Least privilege means what? Least privilege means, anybody want to tell the answer in the chat window? What you understood? What is least privilege? The first principle of security design. What is least privilege principle? So the answer is, when you give someone only the most limited access required so that they can perform their job role. This is known as need to know basis. Okay, the company will write a least privilege policy so the administrator knows how to manage. So company will give a policy for you. According to that, you give the access to them, permitted, limited access, most limited access you will give. That is called no need to know basis. Next, I'm going to talk about data defense in depth. So what is defense in depth? Defense in depth means multi-layered security. Now we are going to discuss about defense in depth. Let's start. Okay, now tell me. As a security professional, you are going to design one security for this company. This is my network. So what all the components you'll put? Where you'll put the component? You can put it in chat. So what components I can install? To secure the network, secure the server. Firewall, very good. So where you'll put the firewall? In this topology, where you put the firewall? Router, switch, side of the router, very good. So we'll put the firewall here. You can put left also, right also, but recommended is, as a logical point of view, we generally put it in the first line of defense. We can put both sides, left and right also. So what I'm putting here, because I'm putting here, first line of defense I'm putting. So I'm putting in the first. In real time, you can use, some places I've seen, they put first here, router, then firewall. Some places they put first firewall, then router, because their environment, no, they have both in a single box. Router and firewall will be a single box. That's why this doesn't matter. But what has to be done is the firewall is the one who is actually, what firewall is doing is the firewall is the one who is dividing the trusted and untrusted zone. That's why we always keep in the first line of defense. So firewall is the one who is telling you this side is trusted, this side is untrusted. So that's why we keep it in the first line of defense. So firewall is the one who is telling you who is trusted, who is untrusted. So trusted and untrusted. This is my untrusted zone. I can't trust this area. This side is my trusted zone. So this is the first function of firewall. What firewall will do is firewall will always tell you this side is trusted, this side is untrusted. So firewall generally has three interfaces. What are they? They are inside trusted zone, outside. Another one is important zone is DMZ. Three interfaces. So trusted zone, untrusted zone, inside, outside, then demilitarized zone. Demilitarized zone. So what is demilitarized zone? Demilitarized zone means I want to allow some public. See, there are some publics are there. I want to allow some public to see some data. I want to allow some public users to see their data with public user. For example, if you are running a company, you have a website, right? Company website. If the company website is for the public to see your company, how the company is going on, all these things. So where you will host or where you will keep the website? Website is kept. Website server is kept. Web server is kept inside one. Inside one network, that's called DMZ zone. There will have a DMZ switch. In the switch, we'll install some servers like this is my file or web server. Okay, so what the web server will do? Web server will basically will host the website. Then apart from that, anything I want to share with others, I will use a lot of other servers in the topology. This zone is called a demilitarized zone, where public can see the data and go back. So this firewall has three interfaces, inside, outside, DMZ. Inside is trusted zone, outside is untrusted zone, and the DMZ is demilitarized zone. As I told you, firewall by default, it will not allow anybody from outside to inside. Default is least privilege principle, it will follow. It will deny all. By default, it will not allow. If you want to allow anybody from inside to outside, or outside to inside or anything, then you need to go for a, for example, you need to go for a ACL, access control list. You need to create a list or rule, you can say ACL or rule. So according to the rule or access control list, it will allow the firewall list. Otherwise, by default, firewall will deny everyone. Clear? Everyone is clear on the firewall? Can I go to next device? Firewall is clear. Okay. Smita, clear? Three interfaces. What is the purpose of firewall? Rakesh, clear, and Sayed, clear. Very good. That's all three are clear. Now next we'll go to the next important device, which will come here. That is called IDS or IPS. So what is IDS? What is IPS? So IDS, IPS means, let me write down here. So first I'm writing down here. Multi-layer security. I'm going to put multiple layer security. Secure my data. See, simple example I'll give you. I have a house. In my house, this is the compound wall. inside house is there. In that house, I have multiple rooms. Okay, and this is my bedroom. In that bedroom, I have So there is one important locker. So inside the locker, I kept some gold. This is my asset. Now, to secure my asset, right? What I did is, I put some. This is my compound wall. I told, right? Compound wall. In the compound wall. Right, I will install some electrical fence so nobody can enter inside my compound wall. Some electrical fence I installed so nobody can jump inside my compound wall. This is the first layer of security. So after that, for example, somebody entered here, I put here CCTV cameras. CCTV I installed. So electrical fence, if anybody jumps also, I have CCTV. Then I have here one door. This is also here. This is also here, access control door. Access control, like biometric is there. You need to show the fingerprint or voice recognition. No? Biometric is there. So it's very difficult to open the door. Biometric access control is there. Then you enter inside this hall. This is my hall. In the hall, there is one door. I'll put here also one door. When you enter inside this corridor, I put one door here. There is also ACS. Then lot of doors are here also there. And another door to get my bedroom. Then I have a door here. This is for again one locking system I created. Very difficult to break. Locking system. Okay, a biometric is there here also. We have multi-factor authentications are there. So locking system is there to break the locking system. After you break the locking system, then will be one snake is there. Whenever you open the door, the snake will bite you. So this is the last. Inside that gold, I kept one snake also with that. Whenever anybody open the door, first snake will bite. Like that I created. So this is the layers I created to secure my gold. This is my asset, right? Understand this concept. This is the principle. See, to secure my gold, I have created first compound wall with the electrical fence. One. Right, understand? One, first layer. Then second layer is CCTV camera I put. Third layer, I put one main door, one biometric. Fourth layer, one more biometric. Fifth, even seven. So seven layers of security is there to protect my asset. This is clear? Everyone able to understand this, what I am telling and what I am trying to tell you? This is called defense in depth principle. See, this principle is what? This principle says, don't depend on only one security control. Please create multiple layers of security so the hacker can, even if hacker crashes one second, he's not able to cross. This is called defense in depth concept. Okay, now if you understand this, the same principle I'm going to follow in our network also. In this network, first I put firewall. Firewall is the first line of defense. Second, I'm going to put the next device. So I'll write down here, first to mine is policies. Company policy secure, make security. Then physical security, nobody can access. Physically, nobody can enter inside the organization. Third, after physical security, like CCTV camera, electrical fence, all these things, then I'll go for a perimeter security. What is perimeter security is? Perimeter means like your firewall, IPS, IDS, advanced malware protection. How many is there? I'm just writing something like important things. This all comes under perimeter security. Okay, then we have after perimeter security, then you go to L2 or L3 or just they say network security. Okay, layer switch and router. Can I put security on switch and router? Yes. There are so many security features on switch and router. Then you go for content security. Content means your web, email, mobile, your cloud, all these things comes under content. The next layer is, then you develop the content security. Then you develop the host security. Host security means, you know what? Host security means you secure the host, the computer. So in the computer itself, you can install so many security controls. What are they? Host-based firewall, IPS, anti-malware, or antivirus. Antivirus is anti-malware only. Antivirus, all these things comes under host-based security. Okay, next is after this, what can I do in next level? So if you put like this, if you see level now, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 4. Five, six, and one more I'm going to give, last one, data security. Even a hacker comes to the host, he break the firewall. See, the hacker is coming from policy level, I'm going to protect the hacker. If policy is weak, he's crossing that and coming to physically, he's entering inside that. After that, he's actually going to the perimeter security, like firewall, IPS, IDS, all these things. He break all these things, compromise all these, then he come for this content level securities. He break that also, then he came inside my system, laptop. Now laptop is breaking now. Laptop, we have host-based firewall, host-based IPS, antivirus, all these things. He broke all these things. After breaking all these things, he came inside the my system and he stole my data. So data security. Okay, what is data security says? For example, I'm going to full hard disk encryption. Even you steal the data from my hard disk, the data is encrypted. You cannot see the data. Even you hack and steal, or you can block your CD drives, USB drive, all these things. So, there are different security features in host level, your data level. You cannot steal the data. Okay, this all comes under multi-layer. So, what is defense in depth means? Multi-layer security. So what is multi-layer security is, we'll have multiple layers of security will be there. Like in the switch, no? In the router also we can make security. Like for example, router if you take, you can make router as a firewall. Okay, or you can make a switch. Switch you can take, in the switch we can put each port. Switch port security can create. Like that in router and switch also we can create a lot of security concepts. This all comes under network security or L1, L2, L3 security. So do you understand now? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 layers of security is there to protect my data. This is called defense in depth. Is it clear? Anybody has any doubts in this defense in depth? Okay, now. This is clear means, Syed is clear. Rakesh clear. Okay, so it's also clear. Rakesh, if there's some question. Okay. Now let's go to that. We'll go for this now. We'll discuss about what is we'll discuss all the devices one by one, but whenever I get time, I'll keep on adding the devices here. The first device I added is firewall. I just gave you idea about what is firewall, what is DMZ. Next, we are going to see the IDS IPS. So what is IDS IPS? It's intrusion. Write down here. IDS IPS. Intrusion detection system. Intrusion prevention system. First, understand important thing you need to remember in this point. Okay. This both are same hardware. Hardware and the functions. So this box is the same box. Functions are same. Then how do I differentiate IDS IPS? The IDS IPS is differentiated. IDS versus IPS is differentiated based on this hardware. The hardware is called sensor. The box is called what? Sensor. So this sensor, how you place IDS versus IPS, how do I differentiate is based on placement of sensor. Now, what is this placement? There are two types of placement is there. Let me write down. Placement of sensor is, one is in line, other one is out of band. Inline mode. Now I'll explain you this. Now try to understand here. There is a one box. It's called a sensor. Let me put this. This is my box. Okay. My box. I'm putting the box here. This box is called what? Sensor. Now this box, how you place this sensor? If you place this sensor here, we call this is as a inline mode. Inline. Inline means whatever traffic comes, it has to go through this box sensor. It's called inline mode. Then the another way I'll place the same sensor is called out of band mode. Another place I place this sensor and I send the data to this sensor. This mode is called out of band or promiscuous mode. Promiscuous mode also some places they use, but out of band mode or promiscuous mode. So when you keep this in this mode, right, what will happen? The data, what data is not going through this, but we will the switch will go to the switch and tell them, okay, you send one copy of data. Copy of data to and copy you send to the this sensor. So sensor will receive one copy. In the switch will tell them, please send a copy from this port to this port. So sensor will receive the copy of data. Copy of all data will be received to the sensor. This is called out of band mode. Now what will happen? In inline mode, out of band mode. First, let's start out of band mode. So in out of band mode, first step number one, what this function, what it does, right? So what is this? This is called the IDS, intrusion detection system. So what is this? First, it will scan all traffic. It will check all the traffic scanning. Second, detect attacks. Now these attacks can be detected in multiple ways. Okay, detect attacks. Third, it will send alarms. Okay, it will send alarms to router, switch, or any administrator is there. For example, administrator sitting here, it will send a mail to administrator, message to administrator, right? That is called what? Send alarms. Now scan all traffic, detect attacks, and this is the three functions this IDS will do. Now same thing, same box I put it here. Now when I'm configuring, I can configure like this. First, it will scan. Yes, same scan will happen here also. Second, it will detect. Yes, it will detect that. Here also it will detect. It will send alarms. Yes, it will send alarms. Correct. Send alarms. The fourth step is it can block also. So in IDS and IPS, the difference is how you place the sensor. If you place the sensor in inline mode, the same box can scan, detect and send alarms, plus it can block the attack. But if you keep it in IDS, it will scan, detect and send alarms. Based on the alarms, as administrator, you can go to log into firewall or firewall device and you can block the traffic. You can block the traffic. This is called the difference between IDS and IPS. Is it clear now? All of you clear what is IDS IPS? How you place the sensor, based on the sensor placement, the IDS and IPS is created, designed. And we use generally use the IDS, more IDS, because when you go for IPS, what will happen? You need to have two IPS, like one IPS failed, no? The impact will be more. So impact is there and there will be a small delay. Lot of devices have to cross and come, no? Delay is there. That's why, you know, generally in IPS, we don't recommend IPS because it may create a delay and impact is there. When the sensor fails, the whole network goes down. That's why we generally recommend IDS, but in some highly critical networks, they use IPS. Okay. All of you clear? Sushmita clear? What about others? All of you clear, right? What is IDS IPS? Okay, Shayad clear? Sushmita, any questions? Rakesh? Sushmita and Rakesh, are you there? Okay, Sushmita is clear. Rakesh? Yeah, fine. Next, we'll go to next topic. The next is another important security component I'll tell you, then I'll go to the, I'll continue the book. So the next component is VPN. So what is VPN? VPN is, for example, I am working from home. I'm a user. I'm working from home. Right? PC2. I have a router. I'm connected here. To go to my office, I have bought one ISP. I went to an ISP. I told the ISP, give us an internet connection. So he connected to me to a internet service provider who connected me to the internet. Okay, fine. Now, I want to access this server. You know this server, you might want to access this server. Okay. Fine. I want to access this server, my file server. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going through this. I have only option. I'm going through the R2 router 2. Then I will go to the R1 sensor. But the problem is, I have a hacker here. This hacker, what he will do, he will see the data and he can hack the data. So how do I protect my data in a public network? See, internet is a public network, correct? So how do I protect my data in a public network? Question understood? The question is, I want to protect my data. So how do I protect the data in a public network? So what are the countermeasures you can think? I want to send the data in public. I have no other option, but I don't want anybody to see my data. So how do you protect the data? Some example. Any method you know that how to protect your data in a public network? You understand my question, right? VPN, okay. VPN is called virtual private network, but what is the countermeasure or technique we are using to protect? See, I'm discussing about VPN only now, but my question is, I am sending a data in a public network. So how do I secure your data? Data in transit. Data is moving in public, right? Transit, na? So how do you secure your data in transit? We studied in confidentiality. Yes, correct answer. Very good. So now I have one option I know already. I know that is protocol, Rakesh. The question is, what is the technique? It is answer is encryption, correct? So the protocol what we are using is TLS, SSL, IPsec, all these things. We'll come to that later. Now what I was telling is, I want to secure my data in a internet. So my data is moving from I'm working from home. I'm working from home here. So working from home. So I am sending a data from to my laptop to my company through a public network, that is internet. So to secure that, I'm going to use a first technique. Remember this. The first technique is called tunneling. OK, so what is tunneling? This is my data. This is my data. I want to secure my data. The first what I'm going to do is tunneling. So what is tunneling? This is a very simple logic. Tunneling means I will take the data. I will cover the data with a huge header, big header. OK, adding header or information, adding information to data is called what? What we call this adding information to data or adding a header to data? What we call, there is a name for that. Adding information to data, covering the data. HMAC is basically you are creating a hash code. Rakesh, you are creating a hash code in HMAC. Sayed, the right answer. That is called encapsulation. So I'm going to do this header. For example, the protocol is GRE header. OK, the full form of GRE is generic routing encapsulation. This is a big header. So now a hacker wants to hack the data. He has to break the header first. For example, hacker wants to hack the data. It's covered with a huge header. OK, when hacker wants to hack the data, he has to break this header first. Then he has to touch the data. Now, once he touched the data also, the data I kept it. For example, he broke the header and he saw the data, but the data is not in plain text. I converted into data into ciphertext. Right? Ciphertext. So this is called what? Encryption. So adding header is called tunneling. Tunneling we call. This is adding header is called what we call? Tunneling, generic routing encapsulation header. Adding header is called tunneling, and this you know already, encryption. Now what happened? Though I am sending my data in a public network like this, okay, I'm sending the public network like this, but what I'm doing now is I am actually converting my data. I'm adding a huge header, and I'm converting the data into plain ciphertext. So what we call this is, we call this as a virtually private network. Physically, if you understand this, physically it is traveling in a public network. Physically, it is going in a network. I added some two important functions or features, security features. What happened? Plus I put tunneling and encryption. Okay, after I do tunneling and encryption, what will happen is it physically, though it's physically going in a public network, virtually I'll consider this as a private network. Virtually is considered as a private network. Now this private network, VPN, we call VPN. This VPN has two types. Major multiple types are there. We'll focus on two types now. They are, first is remote access VPN. We call RAS, remote access VPN. Second, site to site VPN. Okay, now understand this. So in remote access VPN, the protocol is what Rakesh was telling, na? The protocol SSL, or we call this as nowadays we call it TLS. Okay, like I said, VPN protocol is IPsec. Okay, now this is the protocols. It's not one protocol, it's a family of protocols, it's a framework. Okay, IPsec or SSL or TLS is not one protocol, it's a family of protocols. Okay, it uses all the encryption protocol, tunneling protocols, everything it will use. Okay, it's a framework. SSL, TLS or IPsec is a framework. Okay, it's a family of protocols which will contain all the tunneling protocols, encryption protocols and everything. Now, what we are discussing now, working from home, it comes under how it will be designed is, there will be one client software, VPN client software. Can anybody tell me any VPN client software you're using for working from home? What client software you're using for working from home? Rakesh is writing something. Cisco is using. Cisco AnyConnect is one client software. It's a one VPN client software. Okay, there are so many is there. I just wrote one. And this client software has to connect to one VPN concentrator or VPN server. So for example, this is my okay, so this is my VPN server, small input space. So this is my VPN server or VPN concentrator. So what will happen once you the software you can install, and after you install the software, I think I have, right? I have AnyConnect, you see. You can get this, you'll get this like this. And if you give this domain name, I give connect, and it will connect to me to the username password you'll ask. If you give username password, it will connect to my Cisco, because I am a Cisco authorized trainer. So I have a lot of Cisco trainings I'll give. So I have all the Cisco data center access to me. So I can log into the Cisco website, whichever they are given to trainers. So that is, I through VPN I'll connect to the Cisco networks. That is my, this is, that's why they gave me the VPN, Cisco logins. So now when I log in through this client, I will go and connect to this server. So then what will happen? Logically, what will happen? There will be one tunnel will be established between okay, inside the tunnel, data will flow. So basically, the tunnel means what? Encapsulation. Okay, so this is called your VPN tunnel. They say the tunnel is established between, means what? In the client software, encapsulation will happen. In the VPN server, the decapsulation will happen. They'll remove that this one. Whatever you have encapsulated, encrypted, everything will be removed in the VPN. Then it will go inside the network. So this is called VPN tunnel. Okay, now this is this type server client is called remote access VPN. Now there is another type is there, remote access VPN we discussed. Another type is, there is one like for example, this is my I'll put it here. This is my branch office, head office. Like this is my Bangalore office, BLR. So Bangalore office, I have a router R3. Now I have another office in New York. There also I am connecting. I have one network. Let me put this. I have space. I can create some space here. Okay. So this is my Bangalore office. Okay. Then I put one WAN service provider. He is my WAN service provider and connecting to New York router R4. This is New York, but this is a small network, a small company. I don't want to create a buy one WAN connection. So what I'm telling is, I'm telling him, boss, I can't buy WAN connection for that. You please come through. Or another option is, though I have a connecting through WAN, but I'm not comfortable with plainly sending it. I want to use a VPN. So both are okay for me. But in our case, I'm using the internet here, www public network. So I'm sending the data in the public. There is a small network available here. Okay. There is a LAN here. It's LAN. Now this router is connecting to the internet and connecting to this, and it is connected to my company forces. Now this LAN wants to connect to the same server, but what I will do, I will create a tunnel between. See here, I'll create a tunnel between R1 and R4 and R3. Okay, something like this. Okay, now this is called what? Site-to-site VPN. This is my VPN tunnel. The tunnel is established between router to router or firewall to firewall. You can create a tunnel. So this type of tunnel is called what? Site to site, head office site to branch office site, like that. Site to site VPN. Okay, so this is my Bangalore office. This is my New York router. So I created, this is my head office. This is my branch office. So to connect head office to branch office, I'm creating a tunnel. This is router to router, I created a tunnel. Then that is called what? Site to site VPN. For site to site VPN, we use IPsec, and for remote access, we use SSL or TLS. Okay, you can take a screenshot of this. I will send you also this also, very important diagram. This is the basic diagram which we will be discussing on future. Let me put this. Okay, I sent you in this. It's a very important diagram. Keep it with you. Okay, fine. Shall we go to next topic? Any doubt in this topic? Like, What we discussed now is security architecture. There are four principles are there. One is least privilege. Second is defense in depth. Third is separation of roles and responsibilities. Like you rotate the roles, right? For example, you have shift basis. Second shift, next shift guy will come. So make sure that same person is not doing the job. Tomorrow, if anything goes wrong, you really don't know what happened. So you will always have a rotation of the roles. So everybody knows that last guy what he did. So anything fraud happens, we can find out. Then auditing, I told you. Then we discuss about some important, very important components which will be placed where, and malware protections are there. Okay. So anyone is doubt in this? All is clear in the security architecture? Okay, Rakesh, clear? Shayad, Sushmita, are you clear? Yeah, any questions you can ask? Okay, all of you clear? Very good. No questions. Fine. Let's go to next topic. So whatever I'm teaching today, tomorrow I'm expecting answers from you. Please make a note on this before coming to class. Please read and come. Then only I can go deeper and deeper. Okay, if you don't give any answers, no, I can't go deeper, because I when you give more, if when you are more interested in studying and coming, no, we're able to answer the questions, then I can go deeper and deeper topics. Okay. So please study and come, so then the class will be more interesting for us. The next tomorrow also I'll ask same questions. I'll just have some quiz on that. Daily I will start. Whenever I'm starting a class, I will start with the quiz and see how much you are able to answer. Then how depth you are able to answer. Then based on that, I'll plan my next I'll go deeper and deeper. Okay. Next, we discussed now security fundamentals, CIA triad, least privilege, defense in depth. Then we are going to discuss about some controls. So there are different controls are there. We discussed about three controls only. I told you one is management control, administrative control, three controls I told. Now they are showing you so many controls. See, managerial control, operational control, technical control, deterrent control, detective control, corrective control, compensative controls, preventive control, access control, discretionary access control, mandatory access control, role based access control, rule based access control, attribute access control, group based access control, Linux based access control. So many types of controls are there. Then physical controls, physical asymmetry, we already discussed about that. Perimeter security, building security, device protection. Then forensics. With this syllabus is covered. This chapter is covered. Now I'm going to talk about just one line. What is this? I'll tell you. Then if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Okay, we'll start this. So we are going to discuss about what are the different controls. These are different terminologies for different controls. You need to know this because when you are going to use the control, you need to know what controls to be used for what. Okay. Now first, managerial control. So what is managerial control? Manager control is written by managers to create a security organization policies and procedures to reduce the risk. So as I told you, this is comes under policies. So manager, like annual risk assessment, penetration testing, vulnerability scanning, this all has to be done through the manager only. So management has to tell this. We cannot, as a person, I cannot tell every time. As I am an engineer, I'll go and tell somebody like I want to do audit. Means nobody will respect me. It has to come through management. It has to come through the higher management, like CEO. They have to say next week we have a audit. So everybody be ready with the audit. Please prepare all your documents and submit whatever the auditing teams are asking. Please submit. They have to push the audit. So this managerial controls has to come through the organizational high-end managers. They have to make sure that the company is legally compliant with the standards, regulatory frameworks and standards. Okay, like they will do audits on this, risk annual audits, risk assessments and VAPTs. This is managerial control. Second is operational controls. Operational controls means basically you give a lot of trainings, operation training, like we discussed about this also, annual security awareness training, change management. What is change management? For example, I want to change anything in the company, like I want to change a small configuration in the router. What I need to do? I cannot just change the router configuration. I need to send that as a request to a change management, change advisory board, CAB, we say CAB. There are two is there, they will only show here one, but actually there are two is there. One is CAB, another one is ECAB. CAB means basically change advisory board. So it will take 1 week for approving it. But sometimes, no, it's very emergency for me. Within 2-3 minutes, I need to change. Within 1 hour, I need to change it. Or 50 minutes, I need to change it. Means I need to use a ECAB. ECAB is basically, what it does is, it's actually go emergency CAB. It will happen within 10-20 minutes. So there will be emergency people, they will support you. So there are the two departments will be there. So this all you will study on change management. Next, business continuity planning. I told you like BCP is very important in availability attacks. So not only technical, even business people and process also, we need to make sure that. So make sure that there is no single point of failure. If somebody is not there, the disaster happens, the operational must not stop. So not only technical, you need to always have a business continuity planning also. These all things you do it in operational management. Daily awareness of all the awareness of security attacks. Second, how do you do the change in daily basis? Proper process has to follow. Then finally, business continuity. If any disaster happens, how do you protect from the business continuity will not stop? Next is technical controls. Technical controls, you know that firewall, antivirus, screensavers, screen filters, IDS, IPS, so all comes under technical controls. We just know I discussed about that. Now deterrent controls. What is deterrent controls? Okay, deterrent controls means like, for example, in a child, when a kid is there, the kid is telling like the mother is telling like, hey, don't go that side. There is some bhuta is there. Bhoot is there. You know, it will kill you. Don't go. Just to make sure that the kid is not doing any bad activity, the mother will create some small fear so that the kid will not do any malicious function. That fear creating, it's called deterrent. Deterrent means, like, for example, there is a CCTV. Motion sensors are there. Yeah, a thief will afraid to come, right? He'll afraid to come. His CCTV camera is there and motion detection sensors are there, means he'll afraid to come. Okay. If someone is walking past the building, the motion detect them, they turn light on and deter them. Deter means they'll afraid them. See, there's nobody is actually, the deter them is make them afraid. When a thief is walking, suddenly all lights comes, no? Thief afraid, thief afraid, no? Like that. Or with a sign saying that this that is being filmed by CCTV prevents someone breaking the premise. So there is a big board is there. This area is protected from CCTV. Like the big boards are there, no? They are all nothing but deterrent controls. Actually, there is no camera also. If you put 2-3 boards, people will think twice to do the attack, do the malicious attack. Okay, this is all deterrent controls. Detective controls, you know, log files, CCTV records, is not detective. After attack happens, how do you detect? Corrective controls, like a fire happens. After fire happens, what you do? There is a suppression system. They will send a gas, right? Send a gas and it will actually stop the fire. That is fire suppression systems. That is corrective. After the attack happens, how do you recover? So corrective controls. Compensation control means it's also like a alternative or secondary controls. If what happens now? When you implement a primary control, sometimes the primary control fails. You need a backup control. Like example, you are going to spend some 100 rupees. No? They give an example like this. Suddenly you have some issue in the money. Then you have another 20 rupees always kept as a compensation. If anything goes wrong, I have that money I'll use. Generally, I've seen that in older days. Nowadays, card is there. In older days, I always keep some 500 inside my purse. Sometimes I'll forget money. I'll always use that money. That is my compensation control. That is compensation. Always have an alternative or secondary controls. Preventive controls like disable user accounts, preventing from not happening. Making the OS very strong so nobody can attack the OS. Preventive controls, preventive countermeasures. Access controls. So what is access control? Access control means three things are important in access control. One is identification, authentication, and authorization. Okay, here I'll write down something, then I'll come to this. I'm going to discuss about access control. Okay, one, we are going to discuss about identity and okay, first, what is identity? Now think like this, for example, I am going to an IT park with lungi and some bunny t-shirt without chappal. Okay, so I'm going with IT park with lungi t-shirt and without chappal. The security, no, in the gate, he will allow me or not? My understand question, got my question? I am going with a lungi and a t-shirt in a IT park without chappal. The person will allow or not? Security personnel, authentication, authorization, counting. No, right? Yes, I got answer from them. So basically, no, he will not ask ID proof without lungi. If you go, no, lungi and t-shirt if you go, right, without chappal, with a drunkard, for example, drunk also, you are fully drunk. So first of all, he will see you and he will not allow you inside, correct? After asking ID proof is next step. That is authentication. Asking ID proof is authentication for me. First step, by seeing me with my dress code and my profile and posture, he will decide he will not allow. This is the first step. This is called identity management. So what is identity? Is basically by profile and posture itself, you stop access. You don't allow them. Example I'll give you technically. This you understood, right? So technically, if you see, there is one laptop. Okay. When I want to, I'll add the laptop. I want to connect my laptop in the network, wireless network. I'm going to office. I'm just connecting my laptop in the company network. AAA server, identity server will do is, there is a product called ICE. Cisco, we have product ICE. ICE is Identity Service Engine. What this server will do is, service engine. What this server will do is, this server will see what OS you are running, what applications you are running, what anti-malware you are running, right? What are the patches you have installed? All these things it will check. If all are match only, he will allow you inside the network. That is called identity management. Everyone understood this? Then it will come login. Okay. Then it will come what can be accessed. See, authentication is what, who can access. then the login is coming. Now that login now screen will come, all these things. First of all, if your laptop is Windows 7, my eyes will say, boss, you are Windows 7, you're not supposed to log into the network. You must be Windows 10 only. So your profile is not allowing me to log into your network. So he will stop by seeing the profile and posture. That is called identity service. Then once your identity service is success, your laptop, OS, application, anti-malware patches, everything is up to date, then it will allow. Otherwise, in some companies, what they do is, if your profile is not matching, they have a separate VLAN. They will put in that VLAN and tell them, please upgrade all these things. Then you come to the production network. They'll put it in a REST VLAN, or what we call is REST VLAN only actually. You put it in another network where we will get a separate different IP address, not this production network IP address. You will be administrator will log ask you, then he administrator will come and update your laptop as per the norms. Once your laptop is updated, then again you can connect to the production network. This is called identity service. Second is authentication. Once all your laptop, everything is profile and posture is matched, then it will ask username, password, login. Username, password you will give. Then when you give username comes under identity here. Now your username is checked here. Yes, you are the guy. How I know you are the guy? By profile and posture, I can verify that you are the guy. Okay, then you give the log password here. Once you give the password, you get the access. Now what access you'll get? What can be accessed is authorization. What can be accessed? Now you cannot access everything, right? That is authorization. Once you got the access, once you started working on the company, whatever you did, that is called accounting. This is called accounting. Accounting means basically what you did. So remember like this. Identity means profile and posture. Okay, identity means profile and posture. Authentication means who can access. Authorization means what can be accessed. Accounting means what you did. Okay, and the protocols. So many protocols are there. Let me write down two protocols. RADIUS, we call RADIUS servers, or TECAX. The protocols. Okay, which is used for this services. Identity and access control services. Is this clear now? You understood what is this identity and AAA? All of you clear? Now we'll go to the book. Book is not talking about technical, but book is telling about different types of access control. That's it. Now we will see the different types of access control. What is access control? Identity and AAA. That's it. That much remember. RADIUS is the protocol. Full form you're asking, Shayad. Full form, I think something like dial-in service, either will come, I'll tell you. So RADIUS full form, if you see. Remote authentication dial-in user service. It's a protocol which is used for authorization and authentication authorization. Okay, Shayad? Remote authentication dial-in user service. TECAX is terminal access control server. Basically, these all are like one thing, but protocol is a language, right? To do that function. For each function, there is a protocol. Always remember, anything I say, I must follow some standard, which is followed worldwide. So the standard is called protocol. Okay. For example, I'm telling something to you, like I'm selling like site-to-site VPN. I need to tell what protocol is used for site-to-site VPN. I said IPsec. IPsec is a protocol used for that function, which is followed worldwide. Like a remote access VPN, what protocol I said? SSL or TLS. So that is a protocol used by worldwide. So anything I teach you, I must teach you that protocol. The protocol which is followed worldwide. There are so many protocols out there. So these are the very important protocols I'm writing. For every the same function, we have so many protocols. Access control protocols are so many out there. Okay. Okay, I think Shayad clear. What about others? Can I go to the book now? Continue the book. Different types of access control. Rakesh clear. Kotara clear. Okay, let's start. So now book, if you see, the same thing they're telling here. Identity, security identifier. authentication is the PIN number, password or PIN number. Authorization is what level of access permission you will get it. Now, discriminatory access control, right? What it does is they used in Microsoft level. The user is only given access to the what they need to do the permission job. They sometimes refer this as user based as user centric. Generally, you know, right? In the file we have full control, modify, redirect. This is called discriminatory controls. Now we go to that file and folder. You do the permission here, right? Like I'll show you this part. Like this, you do properties. These are permission. This one I'm telling. Permission. These all are discriminatory controls. In Windows, generally we use that. Okay. Then we have see they show same thing they showed here. Permissions. Mandatory controls are based on the levels of the data, not on users. Not on the users is the levels. What type of data you are having? Top secret, secret, confidential, restricted. So based on the level of data, you give access to them. Okay. So MAC roles means once the data is been written, owned by the company. For example, owner, steward, custodian. So based on the roles it is classified data. So what is the role? For let's example, three roles are given here. One role is mandatory access control. Owner, Stevia. What owner can do? Owner can read the data. Only the person can determine the classification. For example, one if the writing a secret document, only that level, no higher. Steward is basically the responsible labeling the data. Custodian is the one who stores and manages the classified data. Administrator is the one who gives the access to the classified clearance. That's it. The roles for the MAC. Then role based is you create role. User role, admin role, like that. So based on that, you give access. Rule based means you can put a rule like 8 to 5 p.m. you can access. After 8 to 5 p.m. you cannot access. Later you put a rule. Based on the rule, you give the access. Attribute based means you create multiple attributes. Like, for example, the user attribute is the directory services, department, location. Based on the attributes, you'll get the access. Group based is you create a group. When you give access to one group, right, automatically, whoever is added in the IT group, they all get the access, group based access. We call group policies. I think that's it. And the Linux based means what? Linux permissions. So in Linux we have numbers actually. See the numbers are there, no? 4 read, 2 1 or read, write, 1 execute. So the permissions are there, owner, group and other users, that number. So now if you see this example here, if you have 764 access to file A, to be broken as following is. So what is this one? Warner, group, and all are read. Just to down. So read means what? 4. See, understand this again. I'll tell you. Warner first, second group, third all other users. Okay. Now numbers are this. 4 means read, 2 means write, 1 means execute. Now when I give 7, what is 7? 4 plus 2, 6, 7. So owner can read. First is owner. The first is the owner. Owner can read. Then next is what? Group. That group can read and write. Others one. Last one is others. Others can only. 4 means what? Read only. Do you understand this? Everyone is clear on this? How this is happening? You want me to explain in another way? That case is clear. What about Shayad? Shayad, you're able to understand this? How these numbers are making sense? Okay, very good. I think then it is called another way to give permission is the alphabetical values, another method. R means read, W means write, X is like this, you can give R, W like that. Different methods of giving the access. Then physical controls, we discuss about perimeter security. Like signage, fences, access control, light you put lights, cameras, robotic sentries. See robotic, this is robotic sentry. Nowadays, robots are there. Industrial comage, we are used multi high security area. We'll put aerial photographs, making high building decision houses like that. And building security, security guards, two personal control, batches, key management, man traps, security, promissory cards, tokens, so many. Controls are there, biometric locks, electronic lock, burglar alarm, fire hose detectors. internal protection, conduits, environmental controls, device protections. So you put a box, cable lock, air lock, air gap. So air gap means the computer is taken off on the network and has no cable or wireless connection. The data is not stolen. For example, there could be computer resistant environment. We can prevent it by network cable. Yeah, air gap. Then tip, laptop safe is there. USB blockers, data blocker is there. So many is there. Automatically, whenever the data is isolated, then the computer is isolated. Automatically, this all gets locked. Okay, Faraday cage is basically a metal structure where other system cannot affect your network. Okay, it's a Faraday cage. Okay, now digital forensics. We discuss about digital forensics. What is digital forensics? Is finding digital evidence for the cyber crimes. That is forensics. So now we'll see this example here. Some examples are given here. What are the forensics examples that are given? Let's see that. Now collection, examining, analyzing, and reporting. The report will go to the court, and the court will take care of the action. That is called your forensics environment. Collection, what are things can be connected, examining, and the analyzing, and the reporting. Now when you see this, the data will be hashed. What is hashed? Hashed means we will run the data, put it in the algorithm, and we'll create one code. Tomorrow, after some time, if you see the data is tampered or not, we'll check with the hash. Okay, so because before any examination, we will make sure that the original is not tampered. So how do I know original is got tampered or not? First, I'll take a hash of the data, then I'll start the examination. After analyzing the data and analyzing the transformed data as the evidence, then report that to the evidence to the further convention. Okay, admissibility, order of availability, these all are different, we look on this term, different components are there. All evidence relevant to the case is deemed as admissible. If only if it is relevant to dispute facts is called loss. So admissibility means what? Relevant to the case. Order of availability means, for example, availability means something will go after some time. Volatile memory like that. So you have to make sure that, say you are a firefighter and you are arriving at a house on the fire, you can save items one at a time. There are two items inside. The fireman, first is a showman, and second is a rib of beef. So you are in a dilemma, which one you will choose? Easy, you save the fireman first, so the melting. So the rib of vegan can the other in the firefighter can I suffer. So basically what they're telling is there are some volatile memory will be there, volatile data. What is volatile data is basically whenever you are capturing a data, some data will be goes after some time. Like for example, in RAM, some data is there. The RAM, when you power of the laptop, the RAM data will go. So first, what a forensic investigator will do is, forensic investigator will go and capture the volatility. See the what is the order of volatility? What will go first? So he will first protect that. Like for example, there is a fire is there, snow is there. Snow will melt very fast, right, in the fire. So first you protect the snowman. Then you protect the rib of beef means some non-chicken mutton like that is there. So one ice is there, snow, chicken mutton is there. Which one you protect in the fire? First ice, because ice will melt first. That is the volatility means what? Basically, how fast it may volatile. Volatile means it will go. Okay, so in forensic investigation also, we will make sure that first what you have to take. Because within 1 hour, that the whole data, when somebody restart the laptop, the whole RAM will be gone. So before restarting the laptop, without doing anything, first time you take the full RAM image, you have to take a backup. So that's called my order of volatility. Like if an example they're given you, web-based attack, attacker is attacking a company website and security team, trying to capture the network traffic to find the attack. This is the most volatile evidence. So that time you have to capture the attack, right? That is the most volatile evidence. So what the insider is attack inside a computer, when someone is attacking inside a computer, order of volatility. First you see the CPU cache. See, this is very important. Then first CPU memory. Cache means temporary memory. CPU memory, then RAM memory, then swap or virtual memory, then hard disk. This is the order. Because CPU memory will go, right? Within a few minutes, it will go. Few seconds, it will go. It's a volatile memory. Then RAM also, power off and power on, it will go. These two is very important. Then virtual memory also, you take a hard disk. In the hard disk, you make some area as a virtual RAM. So that also when you power off and on, the memory will go. So you capture the information from these three memory, then you go and capture the data from the hard disk. Hard drives always will be there. Then the fourth is removal hard disk in the computer. Then you can do this some test there. Just given this command, netstat. I will not restart the machine. But I'll just see this command what it is doing. Some practicals are given. Netstat space AL. So what is this showing is it's showing you the what are the ports are down. If you run this command, it will restart my system. But if I am not restart now, but you can try it out. This actually, these commands are there. I'll send you this 5 minutes practical. Copy. You can try this in your system. After the class, you can try. Okay, so 5 minutes practical, you can try. So what will happen here? We will actually go through the what are the systems are running here. What are the ports are running here? You can see that. And what are the port numbers are running? All the details you can see here. If you restart and see, the data will be gone. So now what you are trying to say here is once you do like this, again you restart the machine and see that whatever data you collected here, the same data will not be there next time. That's called voluntary. So whatever now it is there, the same data will not be there next time also. So make sure that whenever you're capturing that, make sure the collection is very important. Okay. Companies suspended all the color review reports, the chain of custody. Okay, very important. What is chain of custody? Chain of custody means whenever you collected the data, you make sure that the data is not gone with anybody without any documentation. For example, I have collected the data, a hard disk. This hard disk is submitted to the judge. Now judge will ask you, show me the chain of custody. What is chain of custody? The data is collected on this date and this is given to this custody. The police is having this for 1 month. After 1 month, the same hard disk went to police, to the forensic department. That in forensic department was there for 2 months. After 2 months, total 3 months now. After 3 months, this came to for forensic department. It came to the judge. So last 3 months it is stored here. Custody, it was in the custody of police 1 month, after the custody of forensic team 2 months, then it came to the judge court. This is called chain of custody. How the evidence was maintained, who maintained the evidence, that is called chain of custody. It's like missing entry of chain of custody document is a danger. If somebody says there is a missing entry, is there in the chain of custody document, somewhere it is missing, somewhere you are not properly maintained, means the evidence will be not taken as a the evidence is actually dismissed. When you go to court, if you don't submit the proper chain of custody, your evidence will be dismissed. Okay, and they are given some examples for that. Evidence leaves a directive possession, provisions, legal hold, all these things you can go through. Data acquisition, artifacts, time set, time offset, time normalization. Time, basically what time you are collecting the data. When we collect the data evidence from computer, we should record the time offset. This is a reasonable time, multi-external investigation, all the sequences properly maintained. What is time normalization? Time normalization is bring it them in a standard time, like a GMT, you know. GMT everybody knows, bring it in a standard time. Examples are given like New York, London, Berlin. You maintain a standard time like that. Otherwise people don't know which time you are taken properly taken. And timestamps. Timestamps are very important in forensic investigation. What timestamp you have, what time you collected the data, and this all has properly maintained the timestamps. When they access the data, when the file is created, when the last file is modified, when somebody is accessed, the last accessed, all details will be there. So created, modified, and access is there. And copies. When you are going to do analyze the data, you must not analyze the original data. You need to take a copy of the original data, then analyze the data. It's called forensic copies. And capturing system images, firmware, snapshots. Snapshot is nothing but the evidence of from the virtual machine. Take a snapshot of virtual machine and export it as for investigation. Always take a snapshot of the data, then you do the investigation. And screenshots are nothing but the applications of virus on the desktops on that. You take some screenshot of the evidences. Somebody says virus is there, means you take a screenshot of that virus, then you maintain that. Better way to using smartphone, using a geotag as evidence. Yeah. Taking hashes, I already told you. Tetrag remote and traffic and log is a very good SIM tool. You know what is SIM tool? Anybody? What is SIEM? SIEM tool. It's a very important tool in forensic investigation. Anybody knows what is SIEM? Okay, I'll tell you the answer here. So SIEM means security information event management. Okay, now see what will happen in real time. There will be so many security devices will be there. Now I am a security consultant, security analyst. I need to analyze the data. How do I analyze the data? I have so many routers, switches, firewall, IPS, IDS, AAA server, web security server, email security, and so many things are there. So what I will do, I will maintain one centralized server called SIEM server. What that server will do is, step number one, it will collect logs from all security devices. We need to install agents in all the devices. Okay, you have to manually go install in all the agents in all the devices. Once you install the agent will collect all the logs and send it to the SIEM server. All security devices. Second, what it does is, normalize means what? Normalize logs. Meaning what? Meaning bringing in a standard format. See, in some devices the first date will be there. Some devices that something date will be something different. So they bring it in. Now, for example, I told you one timestamp normalization, right? All comes in GMT like that. So they bring it in a standard format. So easy for you to manage. Third one is aggregate means now you will compare. Or you can say like correlation means you will compare the logs. For example, firewall is saying something like that, and IDS, IP is saying something like that. What is the two people are saying? Then you compare all the logs. Then finally, he will give a report saying that yes, there is attack. Please do the needful. Like a report will come. After you get the report, you cannot directly go and do countermeasure. You need to verify that detailed search option has to be there. Detailed search option. Meaning what? You need to know, for example, they say there is an attack. I need to go and check that report came. I will log into this SIEM tool and I'll start checking that. Why he is telling a log? Why it is attack? Why on what basis is telling attack? All this thing I'll search. I will find out after I'm convinced this is real attack. It's not a false alarm. After I convince the real attack, after a detailed search, then I will go and do the countermeasure. This is called SIEM. So SIEM is an important tool in your SOC, right? Security Operations Centers. We have Video Wall and VAPT tools. Are very important things in SIEM. See, for in SOC, what all technologies will be there? For example, anybody ask you, SOC, what all technologies will be there? You can say this. Video wall will be there. VAPT tools will be there to do the analyzing everything. Then we have something called ticketing software. All the tickets will come there. Ticketing software will be there. Then we have SIEM will be there. So the four important tools or technologies you have to study if you're working in a SOC environment. Clear? Understood what is SIEM? Any questions in that? So in forensic investigation, this is an important tool we'll be using in the forensic investigation. We collect all the logs from the here only. Like the example softwares are SIEM softwares. Splunk. IBM has something called QRadar. So many other, and some freewares are there. Elk, Volker, freewares are there. It's a freeware. So there's different tools are there. Splunk Curator is a very big important tool. All over the world, they are using it. And this is the Elk is a freeware. So this topic we study in the course called CSA. In the course, we'll study all these things. Easy ones, we have a course for this, SIEM. So what they are showing here is, you collect the logs from SIEM tool. example, they've given you some example SEM to how to collect the logs. And you talk, capture the videos, interviews, preservation, properly save the data in the original state. Always remember, in forensic investigation, the original state has to be produced as evidence in the court. If you tamper the original state, that's it. Your data is, your evidence is dismissed. Very, very important, okay? So whatever data you collected in the original state, you have to be producing that original state as evidence in the court. Recovery, collection, counter-identity collections, active login, okay. Cloud also, we have forensic nowadays. Verify number of cloud forensic, purpose of the cloud, type of the cloud tools they are using, and type of the technology behind the cloud they are using, role of that, who is the service provider, all this, verify that. And write of audit clauses. See, basically what will happen in the cloud, right? The main thing is you are storing the data in somebody's data center. What is cloud computing? Cloud computing is storing the data in somebody's data center. So I am as a person, I need to make sure that are you properly maintaining my data or not? So you have to do audit on that. So, but some service providers know, they will say, I don't allow you to audit. So we have our own audit reports. I'll share the audit reports. I'll not allow you to audit, they'll say, but you need to make sure that you have a right to audit or not. When you are installing the, when you are implementing that cloud services now, you have to make sure that the cloud service provider will allow you to audit or not. That is called right to audit. So they will check, they will see all that auditing, all the things, they'll verify that, gifts and gratitudes to company employees, commissions to brokers, all these things. These all are right to audit. Then regulatory standards, I told you. That's it. Okay, so we finished chapter one now. Okay, do you have any questions in this, or can take a break for 15 minutes now? Then we'll come back and start the PKI, public key infrastructure. It's a very big topic. I may go today and tomorrow also this topic, PKI. Then we'll go to PKI is clear means, then we can go next. PKI is a big topic, we'll take time. So PKI is starting with public key infrastructure, and then we'll go to identity access management. Okay, now we have finished chapter one. Okay, any questions in chapter one? Okay, we have any questions in chapter one? Can we go for a break now? Okay, what I will do, I'll start one timer, 15 minutes timer. Okay, I will start a timer now. I'll just take a break. After 15 minutes, we'll start the class. I continue the class. Okay, I'll start the timer now. Okay, I'll come back after 3 minutes. Okay, let's start. Okay. So we finish this. Okay, all are back. Shall we start? Rakesh is back. Okay. Okay, we start. Now, we are going to study chapter 2. So, chapter 1 we have completed. Understanding some fundamentals. Now we are going to learn PKI, public key infrastructure. Okay, before going to PKI, I'm going to ask you, I told you like next chapter we are going to discuss about encryption very detailed level. Okay, so we'll discuss on this now. So maybe today and tomorrow we'll go through these topics. It's a little bit big topic. After that, these all are okay. We can manage that, no issues. Okay, let's start with this first PKI. So what is encryption? Answer in the chat window. Start from simple question. Start with a simple question. What is encryption? Converting data into non-understandable form. Okay, we got answer from Shayad. So what is encryption is converting plain text to, let me write down here. What is encryption? Okay. Converting plain text to cipher text. Okay. It's called encryption. Now, how do I do that? I will use a plain text. Right, I'll take a plain text. In the plain text, what I will do, I will use one algorithm, encryption, or like encryption algorithm. Or some people will say protocol, some people say just say cipher. All are same. Okay. Now, for this algorithm, I will generate one key. Generate key. Using this algorithm and the key, I will encode the data and we will generate the plain text to, I'll convert the plain text to cipher text. I think I already discussed this with you. All of you know this, right? Did I explain you see the cipher? Yes, correct. Okay, now we'll not go to Caesar cipher now because we already discussed about this. Now I'm going to talk about important thing, like what are the two types of encryption algorithms we have? Just tell me the answer. Two types of encryption algorithm and what are they? What are the two types of encryption algorithm we have? symmetric. Symmetrical algorithm, asymmetrical algorithm. What is symmetrical algorithm? What is asymmetrical algorithm? What is symmetrical encryption algorithm? What is asymmetrical? Okay, very good. Same key is used for symmetrical for encryption and decryption, encrypt and decrypt. So we use the same key, right? Key pair is used for encrypt and decrypt. Okay, now what is the key pair called? What we call that key pair? Private and public. Very good. So private key and public key. This is the key pair, name of the key pair. Now, as name says, private is not shared. Remember, public is shared. How we share public key? Share via what? Yes, the answer is digital certificate. Okay, till here I explained you in the last class. Digital certificate. Okay, I stopped here. Now, what are the protocols I told you is something like a triple DES, AES, symmetrical encryption protocols. And asymmetric encryption protocols are, we discussed like RSA, Diffie-Hellman, elliptical curve cryptography, ECC, like that. These are the protocols we discussed. This is the till now we discussed. Okay, till now anybody has any doubts? Encryption is clear. All of you clear, right? Because now I'm going to teach you PKI, public key infrastructure. But if you are not clear on these basic things, it will be difficult for you to understand PKI. Next, if this is clear for you, then I'll ask you next question. What is hashing? What is hashing? Next question, what is hashing? Very good. One-way encryption. So now try to understand this. This one-way encryption means I will give you input data, I'll put it in the hashing algorithm. It will generate a hash code. That's it. Using this hash code, I can verify the integrity of the data. The receiving end, again, I'll generate the, this is called hashing. So what is HMAC? What is HMAC? Data, hashing algorithm, plus extra some more we are going to add, because hacker is very clever. What intelligent, what he'll does, he will not change only the data, he will change the algorithm hash code also. Because of that, we will use the extra one phase password kind of thing, that's called it public, pre-shared key. PSK means pre-shared key. Pre-shared key means already shared through internet or mobile or email. It's not sent in there with the data. Pre-shared key. Then using this pre-shared key, you generate the hash code. Now the hacker cannot generate the hash code without a pre-shared key. So this attack will be prevented from HMAC. So this is called, now why we are saying one-way encryption? If you do encryption, you can do decryption. For example, I give a plain text, you can give ciphertext. If I use ciphertext, I can use plain text. But in hashing, if you give input data, I will give you a hash code. But if I give hash code, return is not possible. You cannot give input data. Okay, this is not possible. That's why we call it as one-way encryption. It's converting plain text to some unreadable format. But unreadable figure, I cannot bring back to the readable format. That is not possible. That's called, this is used for integrity, mainly on integrity. Okay, I think all of you clear on this part. Now I'll go to the PKI. PKI means public key infrastructure. Now, how do I share my public key? Share my public key, I am going to build one big infrastructure. Okay, the answer I told you is digital certificate. Okay, that's it. That is the answer. But digital certificate, who will give you the certificate? How it is created? It's a huge infrastructure is there. We have to build that infrastructure. So in that, so many components is there. PKI components. PKI components. Let me write down some 10 components and we'll start with the 10, understanding 10 components. Then we will go to the full first. Now first component is, who will give the, what are the digital certificate? Digital certificate. Standards. Some standards are there that we'll understand first. Second is, what will be there in digital certificate? You can anybody tell me what will be there in digital certificate? A simple question. Anybody can tell me in the chat window, what will be there in a digital certificate? No, no, that's okay. Who is issuing is not a problem. What is the information we are actually having in digital certificate? Why we are buying into the digital certificate? What we are studying now, what is the topic we are studying now? What is the topic, the chapter name? Yes, so remember, in a digital certificate, why we are creating digital certificate, why we are doing creating digital certificate is to share the public key. Very, very important question. Very, very important question. OK, if anybody asks you what will be there in a digital certificate, so many things will be there, but the first answer you have to say is, digital certificate, what will be the digital certificate? If anybody asks you, first and foremost answer is, it will have public key. First answer. Now, let me draw a topology, then I'll explain you this, how this is happening. Okay. Let me create a small topology first, then we'll discuss. Now, there is a PC is connecting to a switch. There is a server. And there is a router. Going via internet. It's internet unconnected. Router. Okay, let me write down now. This is connectivity. Okay, this is PC1. This is a RSA server which will generate the public key and private key. So this is the server generating, understand, generating public key or, okay, let me put public key, private key, generating keys, key pair. Let me put like this, enough. Now, this is my certificate authority server, CA server, CA server. What he will do, he will issue the certificate. This is a server called the CA server. It will issue the certificate. How can I say is issue means sign and issue. Sign and issue the certificate. Okay. This is one server. Now this is internet. I see. R1, R2. PC2. Okay. Now go back to this. Now let me take the next what we're discussing here. So this is a certificate. Then there are standards are there. The certificate types are there. Digital certificate standard emission, and then I write on digital certificate types. There are two types of certificate. Digital certificate is there. Let me write down that. One is root certificate. We'll go very slowly. Don't take too much. Just try to understand now. There are so many concepts are there in this. Slowly, slowly, I'll explain you. Okay. Try to understand this one by one. And if you have doubts, you stop me and ask me then and there itself. Clear it out. It's like a building blocks. Step by step, you need to build. Okay. First, what is the digital certificate standard? So let me check in the Google. What is the certificate standard? I don't know. For example, digital certificate standard. What is the standard? Let me see that. Standard is what? X5019. This is the standard. This is the answer we'll get. X509 is the certificate standard. Let me write on that. First, I wrote this X509. If anybody tell you what is X509, just tell me this is one standard. So what this standard will tell is what all the informations will be there in a certificate. That information will be there. For example, if you go to this X209 Wikipedia, if you open, you can see that structure of certificate. It will be having these details. So what is important is for me is public key. So it will have a version number, serial number, algorithm ID, issuer name, validity period before, after, subject name, subject public key information, algorithm, what is the public key, who issued the identifier, extensions, signature algorithm, signature, like that. So many things will be there in the one certificate. This is a standard which is followed worldwide. There are so many standards are there. This is one of the important standard followed worldwide. First, this is the certificate. If anybody asks you what is the certificate we have, so many things will be there in that. Mainly we are focusing on, now I'm going to talk about one thing called public key. Okay. Now there are two types of certificate is there. One is, go back to that. Two types of certificate is there. One is root certificate, another one is device certificate. What is that? Root certificate means CA. CA, what is CA? Let me write down here, CA. CA means certificate. Certificate authority. Okay, the one who is issuing the certificate is called CA. The one who issues, who gives, sign and give the certificate, sign and issue the certificate is called CA. Now the CA, also will have their, and the CA communicate. For example, I'm going to talk to CA. My computer is going to talk to CA. There also communication has to be encrypted. Okay, CA to the user. Okay, CA to the customer. Now that customer to CA communication, I need to have a certificate for that. So this is my CA's details, CA's public key. What will be there in root certificate? CA's details. Same way, what is device certificate? Now, for example, in this scenario, PC1 wants to communicate with PC2. Now PC once will have a generate a private key and public key, correct? Now this is the way generate, both will be generated. Now this key, what he generated, private key, he will take and put it in this machine, PC1. It is not shared, it is there in PC1. Public key, he want to go due to PC2. Then only encryption will happen, right? One side private key, one side public key. That is called asymmetrical encryption. Asymmetrical encryption, PC1 will encrypt with PC private key, PC2 will decrypt with public key. Now I want to give the public key to the PC2. But how do I am going to give the public key? I will first, what I will do, I will send this details, all my details to this certificate authority server. Okay. Now this is called a sending request. Understand this? I am sending a request here. Okay. Certificate. I want a certificate. Let me tell you black color. This is CSR. I don't like this. I want a certificate. Please sign my certificate and give me certificate signing request. Understood? Now I'm sending a certificate signing request to with all details. But I'm giving to give my details. I am PC1. My name is PC1. I'm staying in Bangalore. My location is, I am from India. My company name is this. All the details I'm giving, whatever he wants. And I'll give it all details. I'll send. All with the public key and all details. Public key I have to give to him, all details. Now what this certificate authority will do is, CA will do is, he will verify this and he will charge some amount. It's not free, okay? It will charge some amount and he will give a sign and give the certificate. He will reply. Now the reply will go like this. Given to you. So signed signed and reply, signed and issue the certificate. That will be given to PC1. Now this certificate, what is issued certificate? Now this certificate is sent to, once you receive the certificate, what PC1 will do? PC1 will send the certificate to this guy. Like this, I'll change the other color. I'll put this color. Now PC1 is sending certificate, blue color. Now he sent this guy. Now what you got it? This guy, PC2 got PC1's certificate. Again ask you, what information will be there in PC1 certificate? Can anybody tell me in the chat window? What information will be there in PC1 certificate? Now PC1 send this certificate to PC2. My question is, what information will be there in PC1 certificate? What PC2 will receive it? What is the main information? Very good. The answer is, he will receive the PC1's public key. Now the data, whatever he sends, PC1 sends to PC2, he will encrypt with private key and send it. What PC2 will do? He will decrypt with public key and see it. Understand? He'll have his PC1's public key. Now, once you receive this PC2 receive this public key certificate, PC2 will not accept as it is. Okay, what PC2 will say is, okay, I understand this, but I want to verify you are the right person or not. He will go and ask him, boss, you are right person or not. You gave me one certificate. You gave one certificate, PC1. Did you issue the certificate? You know him? He will say, yes, I know him. Please agree. Like that. There will be a discussion will happen. Now for this discussion, this guy must have the CA's certificate. So what will be there in CA's certificate? in CA certificate, we'll have CA's public key. Whenever the PC2 is asking any question to CA, I got a certificate like PC1 certificate. I want to verify that. Did you really issue the certificate? Then that time when PC2 is sending anything, any communication to CA, what PC2 will do? He will encrypt with his public key and send it. And he will be only having the private key, who CA server. He will not share his private key now. So using his private key, he will decrypt and see the data. Then he will encrypt and send the data to PC2. PC2 will again decrypt with public key and see that. So this communication also having encrypted communication with using public key and private key. So PC2 will have two certificates. One is, this is called PC1 or subject. Subject means this PC1. Subject. Or PC1 ka certificate. Another one is CA or root certificate. Root means CA. Root certificate. Okay, anybody questions in this? You have any questions in this? What is who is issuing the certificate? What is CA? Clear? Okay. Rakesh, clear. Sayed, okay. What about Susmita? Susmita, you able to understand? Okay, good. Now I'll go to next. Now what I told you is two things. Let me go back to the components. I'm going to keep on going to add the components so you slowly understand. Now first I talk about a standard, and we discuss about two types of key. Then we discuss about what is CA. Now I'm going to talk about CA types. CA types. There are three types of CAs there. Okay. Or you can say like instead of CA types, let me like what you call is signing. Okay, let me put no problem. CA types. Who is authority to give the sign the certificates, right? Or you can say signing methods. Another way of saying is signing methods. Now the first method is self-signed. Self-signed CA or self-signed certificate. What do you mean by self-signed? I am not going to ask any CA. I am myself, I am CA. I will issue my certificate. Like that, some firewall, some router can do it. That is called self-signed certificate. But self-signed certificate is very good only for within your organization for lab or testing purpose. For lab or educational purpose, okay. For training purpose, you can use self-signed certificates. But if you're going for outside, no, you cannot use self-signed certificates. Internal purpose, you can use it. Next method of certificate creating is, how do you create certificate? Is self-signed certificate, certified or certificate. Second is enterprise CA. What is enterprise? Now, enterprise CA means what explanation I gave you now, right? This diagram. This diagram, I explained you, right? This is actually enterprise CA. This is the enterprise CA within your organization. So this is okay within your organization. Okay, within your organization, same organization, okay. So enterprise CA is okay for same organization, okay. If you are going in public network, public organization, like you want to connect, like a bank is there, HDFC bank is there. Okay, there, no, it is not possible. Like for intranet, it is okay. Intranet means what? Private network, private network. Private network, it is okay. Within your organization, you can use enterprise CA. You can create your certificate and give to all the person, and they can install and you can access that. You can do encryption, decryption. But if you are going for public network, public, then you need to use third one, that is public CA. Like HDFC bank is there. HDFC bank I want to access. HDFC bank I want to access. So what is the this one we will follow? Like for internet, if I'm going through internet, right? Public. Not use enterprise CA, we have to go for public CA. Do you know any public CA? You know, anybody knows what are the public CAs we have? Example. DigiLocker. Okay, where I can see the public CAs? Did my browser have public CA details? Did my browser? I told you, whenever you want to talk to a CA, you need their public keys, correct? CA's public keys. There I will have the, like for example, I make a small scenario here. The same setup I'll create here, but this time I'm not going to use enterprise. I'm going to use public CA. So what I will do, I'll take two machines. I'll put a switch. I'll put a PC here. PC 2. Then we have a router. Now this time I'm not going to use a public CA, private enterprise CA. I'm going to connect through public CA. So what I will do, I'll have a internet and I'll go for a, I'll have one RSA server where I generate the keys. Okay, that is what I need for generating the keys. Okay, then I generated the keys. Then I connected to this. This time I'm going to use here public CA. This is my public CA. So this public CA, I'm going to host my website. This is my web server, for example. I want to host my website. Right? I want to host my website. So this time what I will do, I will use R1 and R2. R1 and R2. This is my public CA. I am going to give, I'm a web server. For example, I'm HDFC bank server. My website I'm hosting. So I have my private key here. Public key I gave to the CA. CA generated my certificate and sent to me. Okay, I have the certificate. Now I'm sending my, and I'm sending my certificate to this guy, PC2. Now when you receive the certificate, what will happen? You received a PC1's certificate. First thing, what this guy will do is, he needs to talk to the public CA. First of all, who is the public CA? I don't know. Let's try this. I'll go to a HDFC bank. Let me open HDFC bank net banking. One website I'm opening. This is my page. Now I'll go and click this. Connection is secure. Certificate is valid. Okay, details. Yes, I got version. Serial number, algorithm, hashing algorithm, issuer. So who issued my certificate? DigiSet. Okay. So my issuer is DigiSet. DigiSet. Okay, that is my issuer. Okay, fine. I will catch DigiSet now. So my question is, now I know that my public CA is HDFC Bank of public CA is he purchased from DigiSet. Now, how do I know? How do I go to DigiSet? Did they have any information about DigiSet? Because I need to ask a request now. I'm going to ask it. Boss, can you validate it? Valid request. Can you validate and tell me yes, it is good or bad? Okay, now to do that, I have to encrypt with the DigiSet ka public key, right? DigiSet public key. Where I'll get the DigiSet public key? The question is, from where this PC2, will get the DigiSet public key? Because the communication has to be encrypted. Now it is sending the communication through internet to this public CA. So where this PC2 will get the public key? Do you understand the question? Yes. So the answer is, every browser, understand this, every browser, let me write down here, browser will be pre-installed. Pre-installed with all CA's certificates. Means root certificates. Understood? Every browser is pre-installed. Now, how do I verify that? I'll go open a browser and verify that. Is this having DigiSet or not? Let me verify that now. I'll go to the browser. I'll go to this and go to the settings. And I'll go to the type here. I can search here. Yeah. Search certificate. It's coming. Security certificate. Yes. Now, CA DigiSet. See, can you see that? DigiSet. So many certificates. This is a certificate of DigiSet. Now, if I open this and see what will be there in DigiSet, see, this is self signed. Can you see that? DigiSet is issued by whom? DigiSet only. DigiSet is self signed. This is not issued by somebody else because he himself is a DigiSet, is a CA. So he cannot ask somebody to sign and give to him his certificate. So CA is a DigiSet is a self-signed certificate. Okay. And what is the details they kept in? Same thing. They kept the important details, public key. This is my public key. Okay, this is the public key. We kept it in the DigiSet. Okay. So now every browser will have all CA's data. The moment it sees this, page sees this is the what do you call? The moment it sees that this guy is issued by DigiSet. Right? Issuer, DigiSet. Then he will go and use that public key and access that. Let me go. Now you know the browser DigiSet is there and it'll send a request that I got a PC1 certificate. In the PC1, you are saying, he sent me his public key and he's telling you are certified, you are signed and verified and signed it. Did you verify and sign it? Yes. He'll give a reply. Okay, yes, valid. Yes means valid. No means invalid. It's valid. Now if you go and check in my browser, it is saying it is the connection is secure, means it is valid. Understood? Certificate is valid. So it is verified and told. This is the way public key infrastructure works. Okay. So this is PKI in a high level, I told. Now, if we go deeper level, we'll see this. We'll go tomorrow. What we will do, we'll go deeper and deeper level. We'll discuss on that. But as of now, any questions your side? Anybody has any questions? What is, let me write down here. What is public CA for internet we have? Okay. So do you have any questions like DigiSet, GoDaddy, some of the important public CAs? GoDaddy. Next one is what we call Microsoft compute that also. You can verify that in the your browser. Okay. Okay, this is what I covered today. We'll go more detail on tomorrow. But as of now, you just tell me if you have any questions in this. What is PKI? What is how the certificates are created? Okay. All good. Can I go to next? Okay. Okay. I'll just public and enterprise look same. Okay. Okay. Very good. So public is paid. Enterprises within your organization, you no need to pay anybody. Understood? Public you have to send to them and you have to pay every month. Three months once. The validation period is there, no? You have to pay and buy that. Enterprises you are building within your organization, you are not going to pay anybody outside. Understood, Rakesh? That is the difference. Apart from that, you are creating a CA server, everything is same. Okay. And next is this. See, when you want to become a public CA, you have to go to government, you have to get approval. Like it is something like this. You go to your passport office, you give all your details to passport office. Passport office will verify and give you your passport. The passport is your identity. Whenever you go to any airport, when you show your passport, they will verify that with their certificate authority who has issued the passport. Like for example, in Indian passport, Indian passport authority issued, right? So they verify with the Indian authority, passport authority. Based on that, they will approve it. This is something like this. You need to go and set publicly when you are going, you must go through public CA. Then you have to pay money and buy them. If any doubts, they will verify with the public CA. And this is the way the company, the asymmetrical encryption is happening. And this is called public key infrastructure. In that, so many things are there. Like we are going to cover maybe tomorrow morning, I'll cover this. But if you understand the basics today, tomorrow it will be easy for me to cover. So I'll start from the CA means what? Some topics are covered, offline CA, public CA, right? Private CA, registration authority, subordinate CA, that so many things are there. So we'll discuss this tomorrow. I don't want to put too much today. So next I'll ask some questions now. See how far you understood this. First, what are the two types of certificates we have? Two types of certificates. With that, we'll wind up today. Just I'll revise and wind up because I want to make sure that everybody understood this. So Syed, give the answer. Very good. Root certificate and device certificate. Root is nothing but CA's details. Device is what? What standard this certificate is created? Yes, very good. Not done. Next is, what are the three ways a certificate can be created? Certificate methods. What are the three ways a certificate can be created? Very good. Self-signed, enterprise, and public. Okay, fine. So, Rakesh, can you unmute and speak?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so do you want me to continue or we'll stop today? Because I feel like you people are overloaded. So I just want to make your suggestion.
We got the introduction about the PKI, so we can proceed with tomorrow about the deep.
Yeah, we'll go deep level. Same thing only, we'll just discuss some terminologies.
Okay. Sure.
Okay, you want all are okay, right? We can stop it now, right? Susmita and others. Okay, Syed is clear. Susmita, okay, fine. Because I don't want to push too much also, because the same thing tomorrow, if we start now, we can go on deeper level, faster level also we can go. And everybody please study and come today. Today's topics, then it's easy for you to tomorrow to cover. Okay.
Sure,
okay, everyone, thank you very much. And how was the class today, Syed? And Susmita, you're able to understand? Rakesh?
Yeah, sir, it was good. We can able to follow up your classes.
Okay, fine. So I'll go this speed only. I'll try to cover one each and every topic. I'll run through the full book also. Okay, Which sure, topics, sir. If you're not, you can please ask me. I'll cover it out. Okay, fine.
Yes, sir, sure.
Okay, thank you. Take care. Thank you very much. Thank you. Take care. Bye.